Hello. We are doing a little bit of a thing here called the OAuth2 dance, where I'm going to try to explain how OAuth2 works using some pieces of paper and some props. So yeah. So OAuth2, you probably know it for logging in at other websites, and it's a little bit complicated. Not sure if it's going to be actually much clearer here. So we have a few things here. We have a resource server with a typo. That would be something like Google or Facebook or Twitter, or like a big service everybody knows. We have something called a client, which is a bit confusing because it's actually a web server or website, like your website using OAuth2. For an example, here we're using a fictional Act2 instance, which is not here yet. Then we have a resource owner, which is an actual person, yeah, somebody who's doing stuff. And in between, we have a user agent, a web browser, that will act on behalf of the different people. So those are the dramatis personae, what you call it? Yeah. Good. So before all of this can work, those two have to coordinate a little bit. The resource server first has to come up with a client ID. And he stores it at his database and also gives it to the client. And the client secret, which they share. And you also remember it. Perfect. So that's the first part of the setup. Also, the resource server defines something called scopes, which is just a list of things that he's providing. Something like basic usage, tweeting, posting to Facebook, whatever. That's just stuff that he does. The client, on the other hand, has something called a redirect URI or postback URL, which is some URL on his side that they will use to communicate. They also didn't know about it, but it's just one thing. So that was the very basic setup. We also assume now that the resource owner is already logged in at the resource server to make it a little bit less complicated. So when that's happening, usually the resource owner sends his user agent to the resource server. And just the resource server asks for password user ID, the human enters the password user ID, and now he's logged in and everything like that. okay, so now what's happening is that the user wants to log in at the website, at the client, at Act, for example. Yeah, he wants to log in or register. OAuth2 actually does both of that. So the resource owner sends his user agent to the website, and the website has something called a login link, which includes the client ID. So the client ID is not the secret. So the login link is a regular link. The web browser gets it. It's a redirect, so it goes to the resource server, showing him the redirect link. Now, because that's the first time he actually wants to log in. It's okay. Now the resource server asks the user agent, or actually wants to ask the resource owner, do we really want to allow that guy to log in here? So he goes back there, he asks him, and he goes back there. Perfect. So now the service provider comes up with something called authorization code, which is just some random string, which he stores in his database, and he hands it back to the and he hands it back to the user agent. The authorization key goes to the user agent. To the user agent, yes. The user agent goes back. The user agent. The user agent goes back via the resource owner back to the website. Sorry. And now he gets the authorization code. Now the user agent has to wait here all the time while the client takes the authorization code, his client secret and his client ID, and talks directly to the resource server, trying to verify if all of those things match together. So we had that. So they match, okay? So now the resource server gets an energy access token, gives it to the thing. Yeah, he's still waiting. He also remembers the access token. No. So that includes something called a GVT, a Java Web Token, which is something you can use to create a user and store user information. Now he has access token. Now you can log in, and now he's logged in at that service. So now you can go back to him and say, yes, you're logged in, everybody's happy. Now, for example, this was ACT, so he registered at ACT. Now what's actually happening, which is the reason why we do all of this, besides logging in, is that the client now can act on behalf of the resource owner with or without the interaction. So this was the registration. So, for example, the ACT server can now go to the resource server and say, please tweet on behalf of this user. Just drop it. Oh, yeah, you need the access token. verify the access token. Yeah, you have to hurry. And access token sends out the tweet, Tux is registered for Yapsi Europe. Yeah, but so that was one thing. But what you also can do is, as long as that client has the access token, he can also act on behalf of the user without the user interaction. So the user could, for example, click on act, I'm going to see this talk, and as soon as the talk happens, the client can just send a request to the server using the access token saying, Tux is listening to this awesome talk. Yeah. Without any interaction here, because he is peering, as he's calling, the access token and can act on behalf of this thing. So that's basically how OAuth 2 works. It's a little bit complicated. You need a little bit of paperwork and stuff done, but it's a quite awesome thing and quite fun to do. Thank you. And (laughs)